Hey there, Eli, coming at you again from OSA Coventry here today with another episode of Ecology with Eli. And today I wanted to talk a little bit about symbiosis. I was hoping to split this concept into a few videos, but today we'll give kind of an overview of symbiosis and what that means, and we'll talk about some examples that I can show you in the shop. Now, generally, when people think of symbiosis, they think of what we call mutualism, which is a symbiotic relationship between two organisms that benefits both animals. Now, technically, symbiosis does not necessarily have to benefit both or either of these animals, but truly, symbiosis really just refers to the individual relationships between two organisms that are found within the same environment. So symbiosis can be between any two animals that interact with each other. Don't even necessarily have to be animals, but two living organisms that interact with each other on a routine basis in the environment in which they're from. So the most typical examples of what we consider symbiosis are truly examples of mutualism, which is a symbiotic relationship that benefits both parties that are taking place. One of the most quintessential symbiosis in the reef environment would be the symbionts that live within your photosynthetic corals and anemones. So a lot of us know that corals and anemones are animals. And yes, a lot of us do understand that the lighting is so important to keeping a reef aquarium because these animals are conducting photosynthesis. But it is not generally these animals themselves that are capable of producing their own energy based on this light energy. All of your photosynthetic corals and your photosynthetic anemones, even things like tridacnid clams and some of your other animals that do conduct photosynthesis, they're actually harvesting the energy of a symbiotic algae or bacteria, generally a type of dinoflagellate algae that lives within the cells of these organisms. So it is actually generally that single cellular organism, that small algae, that small cyanobacteria, whatever it is that lives within the larger organism that conducts that photosynthesis and produces those glucose and sugar molecules that are feeding the larger animal at stock. In essence, none of your corals are actually producing their own energy through the use of sunlight. They're actually harnessing the sunlight energy from the secondary outputs of those photosynthetic organisms that live within them. So generally, people consider those types of algae a zooxanthellae or a type of symbiodinium. There are nameless, countless different species of symbiodinium that live harmoniously within our coral polyps. However, this is not an integral part of that coral polyp itself. The coral, as it does grow, will actually host more of that algae, and sometimes it will grow with the coral. However, if it becomes too large of a colony, these corals can get rid of that algae. These corals can bleach if the environment is not suitable for that, and the bleaching refers to them losing all that symbiodinium. So the coral itself does not actually host any sort of way to harness that sunlight or LED energy that we're using in our saltwater aquariums. And it is strictly because of that symbiotic mutual relationship between itself and that algae that the algae is getting a comfortable spot to live, a place that it can harness that sunlight energy and be somewhat protected from the elements around it and from filter feeding by other organisms. And the coral itself is harnessing the benefits from that symbiodinium producing those carbohydrates and feeding the coral itself. However, if that coral was to bleach, a lot of corals can survive without their symbiotic algae counterparts. So a bleached coral, as long as it's meeting its carbohydrate demands, if it's able to feed on its own, if it is couching its own food particles, a lot of times they will survive for quite a while in their bleached state. And a lot of times they can actually reacquire those symbiotic algae to harness that benefit again. However, it is not up to the coral itself to be photosynthetic, and that is one of the main symbiotic mutual relationships where both organisms, both the phytoplankton and the coral or anemone involved, are actually benefiting from that relationship, and it allows almost all of your reef-building corals to survive. In addition, when we think about symbiosis in aquariums especially, there are a couple examples that are very widespread. We've got things like clownfish and anemones. You see that large pergola clownfish behind me there that is hosting a bubble-tip anemone. There are some species-specific types of clownfish that host certain types of anemone in the wild, but a lot of us are used to seeing this in an aquarium with a bubble tip and either a pair of perculas or a pair of oscillaris clowns. So the clownfish and anemone symbiosis is usually another example of a mutualistic relationship where the clownfish has its own adaptations to be able to live inside the anemone without being stung, so it is therefore usually protected from predators. A lot of other animals that attempt to touch that clownfish or touch that anemone are going to become stung by the powerful nematocysts that the anemone possesses. However, the anemone is also benefiting from this relationship because a lot of times when they do have a clownfish host, this clownfish is actually sacrificing some of its own food to feed the anemone. So anemones are being fed directly by the clownfish, and just the act of being hosted by the clownfish, the clowns oftentimes will clean up around the anemone a little bit so that rock that the anemone is attached to is clean from biofouling. And just the act of that clownfish swimming in and out of that anemone is actively moving water around the anemone and offering it more oxygenated, clean water at all times. So it is a relationship that is benefiting both animals, and something kind of interesting to be able to see in the home aquarium, and something that just makes that clownfish so unique in that aquarium setting and even in the wild, because a lot of times in the wild, you will not see clownfish without their anemone host. So really interesting relationship, something that we're almost all familiar with, but something that is very truly a mutual symbiotic relationship that you can see in your home tank. And while I have some other examples of mutualism in the shop, I did want to show off some of those as well. In this tank behind me here, we have some lovely little pom-pom crabs or boxer crabs. These guys are a really interesting small species of crab that actually hold two small anemones, one in each of its largest claws. And what it does with these anemones is it uses them to sift out food from the surrounding water, to sift food out of the substrate and off of the rocks. And so it's actually using these anemones in either of its claws as basically a fork and knife to catch its own food from the surrounding environment. Now, this does still benefit the anemone because, as you know, most anemones are going to be capturing and eating their own food particles. So as this crab is hunting to feed itself and using these anemones as its own form of protection because it is immune to those stings from this anemone, it is also actively feeding each one of these anemones each time that it does get something stuck to those tentacles. So not only is this crab catching enough food for itself when it is using this anemone as a utensil, but it is also feeding the anemone the entire time. And one of my favorite facts about these little guys is that if they do lose one of those anemones, they are entirely capable of splitting their remaining anemone into two pieces, and they will actually fragment their own anemone a countless number of times to either keep it an appropriate size for handling or to replace one that they've lost. So I think that's a really interesting mutualistic relationship that you could probably see in a very small, peaceful aquarium. But these guys are so small, so timid, that they don't always work in everybody's tank. Additionally, this tank behind me here, you see the skulk cleaner shrimp. We also typically get fire cleaner shrimp in. And they get that cleaner shrimp name because they are actually known to clean parasites off of fish. So one of the main benefits of adding these to a reef or a large aquarium is that they are going to actively seek out parasites like gill and skin flukes off of your fish, and they will eat these off of the fish. So not only are they providing relief to that fish in forms of their parasite burden being released and diminished, but these animals are actively feeding themselves at the same time. So this relationship does also benefit both parties, whereas this shrimp is feeding itself while cleaning those parasites that are actively harming that fish in your aquarium. So another really interesting mutualistic benefit to see in your tank, and something that can come in quite handy if you do have a parasite burden in your tank. And just for one last example, I wanted to show a very similar cleaning organism that happens to be a fish that you could get away with in a lot of your aquariums. So on a very similar note to those cleaner shrimp, there are also some species of cleaner fishes as well. Behind me here, I have a lovely example of a cleaner wrasse, and I figured I'd showcase this guy while I have him in stock as well. These are another really peaceful addition to most of your saltwater aquariums, especially a nice peaceful reef tank. However, this guy also specializes in cleaning parasites off of fishes. A lot of times, especially if these fish came from the same general vicinity in the wild, they will actually recognize that this guy has that mutual symbiotic relationship, and they will allow themselves to be cleaned by this fish. And oftentimes, even fishes that might be predatory in nature might still allow this fish to swim in their gills, in their mouth, and along the side of their body to clean off parasites without harming this animal. So I find that to be a really interesting fact. You can see plenty of pictures and video out there of these guys swimming into the mouths of groupers, into the mouths of eels, and actually not being eaten by these predatory animals, because that animal understands that this glider wrasse is there to serve a purpose. And since he is basically scratching that animal's back and cleaning off the pests that he does not want to host, they pay him a return favor by not eating. But that relationship between the glider wrasse and the fishes in your aquarium or in their environment in the wild is a really interesting relationship. It does benefit both animals once again, because the larger fishes are being cleaned and ridden of those parasites that they were once riddled with. And that cleaner wrasse is in turn getting itself a nice snack. It is eating those parasites and filling its gut. There is some evidence to suggest that this might benefit the cleaner wrasse a little bit more than it generally does their counterparts. And this is because oftentimes that cleaner wrasse is also eating scales, digesting the slime coat of the animals in which it's cleaning. However, this generally does not cause much harm to those other fish and is almost always worth the risk of being cleaned off, but it does oftentimes benefit the cleaner wrasse a little bit more heavily than it benefits the animal being cleaned. However, still a really interesting relationship, still something that does benefit both parties, and something that if you can get away with it in your aquarium is a really fun thing to watch. So I hope you guys found this topic of symbiosis, especially the idea of the good side of symbiosis or the mutualistic symbioses, to be an interesting topic. I hope that you guys learned something today, and I hope that you guys have something, some sort of examples in your aquarium at home that you like to watch. There are so many different examples of mutual symbioses that you can add to your aquarium. And it's one of my favorite things to be able to witness in a fish tank, a witness in the wild, are these relationships that two animals, for one reason or another, are actually benefiting each other and benefiting each other's survivorship and health. In future videos, I plan to cover some of the other types of symbioses, namely predation and or parasitism. So we're gonna talk a little bit more about the bad side of symbioses. Again, like I mentioned earlier, not every symbiotic relationship benefits both parties. And I also hope to do a video at some point on some symbioses that might not really clearly benefit either party or benefit one party or the other. There are plenty of examples of relationships between two animals in which there is a clear relationship but no clear benefit. And I'm hoping at some point to get some good examples in the shot for you as well to showcase those benefits too. As always, feel free to leave questions, comment, suggestions in the comment section below. And as always, keep on reefing.